It is just another video about the Blender's new real-time compositor. The time has come. So yeah, starting from Blender 3.5, compositor got GPU acceleration, at least some of its nodes. All we need to do to enable real-time compositor is get inside this menu and enable one of these options. By default, it's set to disabled, meaning that the offline version of the compositor is used, and all we need to do is go camera, and it will apply the real-time compositing to what the camera sees, or always. This is the option for the entire render view. One thing worth mentioning is that the camera settings would change the operation domain for the compositor. Let's say, if we enable the passpartout option, and crank up the passpartout value all the way to 1, it will effectively constrain the operation domain for the compositor to only this region. And actually, it makes it much more predictable, so I definitely recommend doing it. By the way, this is pretty much it. Blender has a new real-time compositor. This is how you can enable it. But while we are here, let me show you a few interesting ideas of what you can do with it. Flipping the image horizontally is a trick that helps to view your composition with a fresh pair of eyes. So Shift-A within the compositor, distort, flip. And it doesn't work. That is because we forgot to tick the Use Nodes checkbox. This is important. So feel free to flip the canvas on the x-axis anytime to check the image balance, or even keep it this way. One thing that I've been dreaming about for years is being able to make the viewport black and white. And at last the dream came true. By adding the Hue Saturation Value node and bringing down the saturation, we can effectively make the viewport black and white. It is tremendously helpful not only from the standpoint of debugging your composition, but also from the standpoint of opening up some crazy artistic perspectives. Like, imagine doing the whole thing in black and white, starting the entire project in this mode and keeping it this way. How many black and white projects have you seen made in Blender? Now there will be more, and this is awesome. Then obviously everyone thought about adding glare in the compositor. Not that we haven't had the option for enabling bloom in Eevee. Obviously this is super easy to just go and check this checkbox, but sometimes you need something extra in terms of the glow. The first thing that comes to mind is the glare filter, but it comes with a caveat. While the streaking works pretty well in real time, you can tweak all the settings and generate beautiful streaks, the fog glow doesn't. So yeah, this is something to keep in mind while working with the new real-time compositor, is that it doesn't support the majority of the nodes. This is not the end of the world. When it comes to glare, you can still use some streaking to simulate the anamorphic lens flares or something like that, especially if you stretch it horizontally. This is nothing criminal about it. And if you wish to get more traditional glare, you can use the blur node. We can go ahead and pass our render layer through the blur operation, like that. Then go Shift-A to add the mix node and bring in the blurred image. Blurred, I said. Something like that. Then the blending mode should be set to add, and it will create the light diffusion situation. To better control the falloff of the glare, we can use the RGB curves node and make it the S-shaped curve. Something like that. And then the mix factor can go higher than 1. So that is how we can make the basic glaring effects in the Blender's new real-time compositor with the help of the blur node. And the thing is, it works in both Eevee and Cycles, making it a very useful feature indeed. For me, it is quite a miracle to be able to see the post-processing effects being rendered on top of the Cycles render. I've been dreaming about something like that for years. To be honest with you, the first thing I did while testing the new real-time system is just slapping the lens distortion on top of everything. Chromatic aberration for the win, projector for the mode, then dispersion all the way up. Like the bloom, it is another low-hanging fruit. Yeah, it works. It works in real time. The idea number 5, we can do all kinds of color grading for the look development, for example. Classic color balance operations, like mixing in some color using the multiply or color modes. Think about influencing the color temperature by mixing in some blue, for example. How about that? And again, it all works in real time. So we can cool down or heat up our image in post like that, or affect the tint as well by going a little bit of green or purple on the other hand, or on the other side of the color wheel. Then, of course, we have the proper color balance node, which should absolutely be set to offset power slope instead of the lift gamma gain setting, because lift gamma gain is just broken. And then we can do whatever we want with the shadows, midtones, and highlights. Like, change the overall contrast and colorize the image in multitude of ways, which we won't be going into. It all works without a hitch in real time, and so we can use it. Just don't set it to lift gamma gain. Previously, the way we have been doing it, or at least I have been doing it, was using the color management settings, doing the exposure sweeps for altering the basic brightness of the image, or doing all kinds of RGB curves shenanigans, like curving the green channel, for example, for imitating whatever film stock. When you think about it, it was kind of real-time all the time. But anyway, now we can experiment with the proper color balancing pipelines within the compositor. For the extra color grading control, and especially for changing the contrast, we can implement the RGB curves as well. When it comes to post-processing, this is a no-brainer. I use it all the time. It is especially useful if you want to do some peculiar stuff with the contrast or with the response of the individual channels. Then this node becomes indispensable. How about adding the vignette effect in real time? Count me in! The way I usually do it is not super procedural, because I just found out that it's much faster to do this way. Don't blame me, but I use the image texture, this PNG for example, that you can find in the project files, and I just impose it on top of the render with using the multiply mode. By the way, look how it doesn't work right off the bat. And in cases like that, what we need to do to make it work is define the operation domain, or in other words, scale the image to the render size, like that. It will make our adjustment stick to the render dimensions and to the camera view, and that is important when you work with the Blender's real-time compositor, because it often needs us to define the image dimensions. This is the way it works. So this is the easy vignetting effect. How about the film grain, though? We should throw in some film grain, right? This was probably the second thing I did after experimenting with the chromatic aberration. This is not gonna be the most performant way of doing it, I suppose, but I just used the video with the film grain. You can find it in the project files as well. After importing the MOV file into Blender and connecting it to the second socket of the MixRGB node like that, we need to change its settings. First, we should define the number of frames, and for this video file, I will go with 49. Then, obviously, we should tick cyclic and auto refresh, and also change the color mode to linear, otherwise, we will experience some horrific issues with a blending mode. Just trust me. This is the way to go. Now, if we hit play to blast through our animation, we should see the animated noise popped out, which you probably won't appreciate due to the video compression. So, the mode should be set to overlay. I see the noise with my eyes, though. Let me crank up the mix factor so you can enjoy it as well. So, look at that. We got some film grain going in the blender's viewport. How cool is that? For the best results, it should also be scaled down to the render size. So I copied the scale node with using the Shift D shortcut. Oh, and it could be also pretty slow to play the videos like that, but for my computer it kind of worked. So here we are. And the last idea for the real-time compositing for today would be pixelization. Turning everything into pixel art, how about that? The way we can do it really quickly is by scaling down the image by a factor of 5, for example. It is the same as multiplying it by 0.2 and then pixelating it and scaling it back. So we made it 5 times smaller, pixelated it and restored the initial size. And this is it. This is a little bit cheeky effect, but appropriate for ending this tutorial, perhaps. Remember that you can slap this post-processing chain on the entire viewport, like that. And like we mentioned before, the real-time post-processing chain works not only in Eevee, but in Cycles as well, which is arguably even more mesmerizing. Not only we can see the UI overlays put on top of Cycles, we can enjoy the full post-processing chain right now in Cycles. These changes to Blender are really welcome. Feel free to support the developers by donating to the development fund of Blender, which you can find on blender.org. Together with the Blender's community, they are doing an amazing job with improving our software. And I think this is it. Now we have the GPU-accelerated compositing in Blender. Not all the nodes work. It will be fixed over time, I think. This was Gleb for CreativeShrimp.com. Feel free to press like and subscribe to this channel, and obviously drink more coffee.